I have pushed the record button. We're doing a show. I have to push this other thing too. There we go.
Awesome. Swoosh.
The swoosh. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 421, field day 2020. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and welcome to the most important show on the internet. The most important ham radio show on the internet. Hope I got that right. I want to say hi to everybody and bring in my guest, friend, mentor, Elmer, Jim.
Hi, hey, Jim. David.
How are we doing?
Good. Good. How are you?
I don't know. I have no idea what day it is. I'm doing okay. Actually, I know it is Sunday, but it's all starting to melt together, and I have gone a little bonkers crazy in this whole Corona shutdown thing, but that's kind of the reason why we're bringing you a show today, right?
Yeah, we get to go think about having some fun.
Yeah.
Take a weekend off.
I've actually been thinking about this. Field day, I think about every year, but I've been thinking about how this field day will be different from other field days. Will it be different for you than other field days?
Yeah, certainly a lot different than when I started going to field day when I was 5 and actually operated my first one at 14 when I was out in the campground with a bunch of my Elmers long time ago. So it's going to be different not hanging out with people throwing antennas into trees and having beer and bratwurst all day.
Right. And that's what you usually do to get together. Is it a club or something else up there?
Yeah, when I was growing up, it was a big club operation, probably 7 stations set up in a big county park. Mm-hmm. And, the last one I attended was one of the county MCOM groups doing their first field day. Mm-hmm. So they needed all kinds of help figuring out which way to put antennas for, you know, multi-station and all that. And it was kind of fun. It was good.
Excellent. Excellent. Yeah. I have been wondering since this whole lockdown thing had come together in March, what field day would look like this year. And I've gone through a bunch of thoughts and was thinking we'd still all be just safer at home. But you know, in LA here, it seems like everything's mostly opened up. But I'm still not sure I'm going out or I'm staying in. We've been doing, our Aries group has been doing a field day since I joined them. And there was one year we didn't do it. And I don't remember why. It may have been fires or we may have had a hard time finding the location, getting it to worked out. But otherwise, we either work from the local junior college. Pierce College has a really good high hill that has a parking lot that they've been under construction for like 10 years. So they don't mind if we drive stakes and stuff into the asphalt that's not really completely there. And then the last 2 years or so, there's a Nike missile tracking site on the top of the Santa Monica Mountains. And there you can see almost the entire city. And that's a great field day location, except for the high voltage wires that are below part of it. I'm not sure they'll be up there or they won't be up there. And I'm not sure exactly where I'll be. And I know the ARL has lots of questions about what people can do and where they're going to be. So there's been some adjusted rules around that, too, for field day.
Well, I think some of the adjustments are a good thing.
Yeah.
I'll probably stay home because I think we want to shoot and do some live and
yep.
Maybe get some of our folks up on Zoom going, what are you doing? And just see how this works out. I think it's aside from the so-called MCOM value of what can you throw up in the field on a weekend, I think a lot of people still be able to do that in their open areas. And, you know, if you're doing your own camper thing and a station and you can be single op station or figure out how you're going to operate logs 6 feet apart. I think some groups will still try to go out in some places where there's space and if they can get reservations now to do that. But I think this is a great time to take that station you've got at home that you haven't used very much. And, you know, if you're not in a DX contest, you're probably not listening on DX contest weekends. But this is a free-for-all for everybody. So I think it's a good time to everybody check out their home station and find out what it'll do.
Yeah, absolutely. I had been thinking about, you know, what do I do? You know, I've got the box behind me, and that's mostly UHF, VHF. There's an HF radio in there that doesn't get a whole lot of use. And then further down the desk, there's an HF radio that I drag out for some of our Aries nets, and I play around with now and then. And when I started thinking about, well, if I'm still stuck here, I'm going to do, you know, field day, you know, it's called field day for a reason. Right. I did a presentation for our Aries group, and I kind of knew why we did field day. It's get out in the field, see what you can do. It's a big emergency test. It's not a contest, right? We'll keep reminding people over and over and over and over again, right? And we are collecting logs and we are submitting them, but it's not a contest, right? But really, it's all about trying to figure out, you know, meet the challenges of emergency preparedness, see what you can do. And for that part of this event, I think I'm super excited to see what folks are going to do, like really get out and do. And I hope there'll be a lot of people that will try, because I think ordinarily, like, hey, Sunday morning, you know, I've had a lot of Sunday mornings to kind of come out here and goof around. And I shot a little video, I'll show you a little bit later on, of me trying to figure out, like, well, what will field day look like for me? But this will really be a good weekend for folks to say, okay, I am going to go find the stuff that's in the corner of my garage, shack or otherwise, and get those batteries charged up and find that piece of coax and make sure that I remember how to turn that radio on and do all those things and see what would happen if we really needed to respond to some kind of emergency event. And I know there's folks that have a lot of equipment like that, and there's probably a lot of folks that have, you know, as much as just your HT, you know, they can just, you know, get this out. And I want to encourage those folks to get out and play field day too, because I think they can have some, at least enjoy the experience.
Well, I've got a couple antenna projects I need to finish up to get things going, because I like to have the wires and I like to have the verticals up. So it'll be a chance to play with another vertical. Mm-hmm. I hope that we'll get some people. I'm going to try and figure out when 10 meters is open, and I'll focus a little time for the tech operators on 10 meter sideband to do some stuff that'll give me a little new experience figuring out what 10 meters does, because I usually hang out on 40 or 20. Mm-hmm. And see what's going on there. But I think it's a good opportunity for the techs, if they've got access to an HF rig they can borrow. Mm-hmm. You know, throw up a quarter wave, a ground plane, or a 10 meter dipole, and get on and see what's going to happen. There's going to be, you know, a few thousand people in the States. It's a good time to figure out, as the sun rises and sets across the country, what 10 meters is going to do for you. And maybe you'll pick up some JAs or some contacts. But, you know, that's probably one of the simplest things folks can do, aside from that HT and getting on 5.2 or even 440 simplex and working locals. I think one of the groups I get email from said they're going to focus a lot on just get on 5.2 and see what you can do around town. Because a lot of things that folks are involved in Aries do is just their local drill. You know, can you talk to me with your HD? Can you talk to me with your base station? Well, now there's, you know, everybody in your county or your region is going to, you know, hopefully get on, you know, let's see if we stir up 5.2 a little bit, keep that busy. And in times where, you know, if you can't operate on 10 meters, at least tune around and see how the rest of the bands behave. You know, good experimental time. Doesn't all have to be about emergencies, but I think out here in California, if an emergency hits and you can't get out of your neighborhood because there's a big crack in the street, you're suddenly the MCOM place or a potential, yep, you know, to be a relay. And that's good to know. That's what we do this. It's not just a camp out.
Yep. Yep. And we're experiencing some of this particular weekend. This is the ARL VHF contest. And I've been working on cleaning on the garage and getting the shack set up to do the show, I've had the radios on and I've logged a bunch of folks here. And, you know, and that's what folks are doing. They're out and about and doing this and that. And, you know, you can hear some of the stations that have got big rigs and up on hills, and I've heard some rovers and such. And, I was surprised. I hadn't turned on my 220 radio for some time. We don't usually use that so much for our regular MCOM stuff. And I haven't had the time to just kind of hang out here in the garage as much as I wanted to. But there were a couple stations I worked on, four separate bands. Now I definitely had to like play around a little bit to get all that to work. But I think that, you know, that's the model I want to take forward to field day. We talked about, I did a little presentation. I'll share with you guys shortly here. I did a little presentation last week for our Aries meeting, and just talked to them to try to encourage some of those folks to, hey, let's do field day. Let's figure out how you can do. And, you know, you can see the pictures there. On the left there, that's sadly something that we're going to miss, which is the, you know, the public service desk of sharing what we're doing with the public that comes by. I'm going to put a little easel at the end of my driveway with the great letter that, let me switch over to that real quick. The great letter that, the ARL puts out, which is "What is Field Day?" This is a nice one pager. And I'm going to blow that up real big. I'm going to put it out on the end of my driveway so that folks coming by are like, "What's that guy doing?" They can read that and know what's happening. And on the right there was one of the setups that I did kind of off to the side. That year we did Field Day and showed folks what you could do as a single operator in the back of your vehicle and just set up somewhere to do Field Day. But we talked through, hey, you know, what's the whole idea behind Field Day? I was actually kind of surprised it didn't completely grok the whole, you know, idea, you know, the object, and this is from, you know, again, directly from the rule book was, you know, the object is work as many stations, 160, 80, 40, 20, 15, and 10, as well as, 50 megahertz and above, and, learn to operate in abnormal situations, which is really what I'm pushing folks to do, like get out and figure out what you can do. And again, even if you have a handheld, go to the highest part of your house, you know, go sit on your deck or go walk up to a tall hill, you know, and log this out. And really the idea here is developing your skills to meet the challenges of emergency preparedness. That's kind of why we're doing this. And I'm excited to see what might come out of this. This stuff's not so important. The one thing that we came across, actually I do want to share this slide. The one thing we came across, something that I do all the time. I do a lot of backpacking, spend a lot of time with the scouts out in the field. And I tend to follow something called the Wilderness Protocol. And it's something I came across. There's another ham, Scott, WA9STI, brought it up, because he does a lot of soda, and mostly on his own. And he follows this protocol as well. And just in case he can help someone out or someone can help him, which the Wilderness Protocol basically says that, you know, starting at 7 in the morning and going until 7 at night, while you're in the backcountry, every 3 hours, you turn in your radio and you tune to the local calling frequencies that you have, and you call just to see what's going on for 5 minutes. And there's a bunch of benefits to doing this. One is you make yourself known, and if someone needs help, they can make themselves known to you. And the other is you're saving your batteries and you're extending out the time because you're not just listening all the time. And I have proposed to our Aries group as well as the neighboring Northeast group, and we share this a little bit with the folks that support the fire department and the sheriff's department, is, hey, you know, on Field Day, if you can't do anything else and you're not setting up a big rig, I don't have a tower near, you know, at all. I have a couple of little push-up poles, and we'll show a little bit of that. I know, Jim, you've got a nice little setup in the back where you are. But folks that just have an HT or just have a mobile or even a mobile in their vehicle can go out. And if we get a bunch of people to do this, you know, starting, it would be at, you know, 1 o'clock, because Field Day here doesn't start until 11, but starting at 1 o'clock and going on through the day, we could get some real pileups on national calling frequencies on, you know, 14652 or 44600, that could really turn into somebody with an HT really making some points. If you've got a good location and you can see a long way or cover a big area, first of all, handheld, 5 watts is a multiplier, because low power. And if you charged it from an emergency power source, there's another multiplier. There's lots of multipliers here. And again, it's not a contest, but there's all these points things. And I think it's a great concept. I have asked some of the other groups around to, you know, share this out and you know, talk about, do they want to participate? Do they want to get with the program and see what we can do to kind of flood the bands during those times? What do you think?
Well, I think the Wilderness Protocol, it's 3 hours. I'd advocate everybody trying it every hour, every 30 minutes.
Yeah.
You know, normally when you're operating at Field Day, you're either pouncing or you're trolling, mm-hmm. you know, looking for what's out there. And there's always stuff on HF at some point. And, you know, you may create your own pileup. since we have so much time over the weekend and we're not doing anything else, I understand in the wilderness, yeah, you're going to conserve your batteries and mm-hmm. you're probably looking at your map, trying to figure out how you're going to get out or in to wherever you want to go. So we don't usually have that kind of problem sitting at home. So I think doing the wilderness thing every hour or half hour, stirring it up, because some people are just going to get on, listen for a couple seconds and go, oh, there's nobody there. But then again, you know, if you don't make the call, you don't call CQ, you may not know that somebody else is listening. So get on and just give it a try. That'll help out quite a bit. And even if you don't have that good a transmit situation, I think receiving and getting to know the bands and how they behave for you and your location during whatever time of day. And, you know, maybe it's a good weekend to say, I'm going to play with antennas. I'm going to try that dipole. I'm going to try that vertical. Mm-hmm. I'm going to get the thing out of the man pack or the camping bag. I've got a vertical I haven't put up in a long time. That's an experiment I'm going to try. And I can switch between multiple antennas. And it's kind of amazing how the cheap vertical in the backyard is sometimes a lot better than the big piece of wire that's up. And that's a learning moment. And I think the idea of contest, not a contest, the fact that scoring is weighs heavily on emergency power and what you can do in that circumstance, what you charge from. Our solar power here is out at the house. So I can't really say I'm going to be a solar powered house, but I've got a pile of batteries and a couple of 100 watts of solar on my Airstream. I can jumper the Airstream into my battery pack, and I'm pretty sure I'm not going to lose juice for 24, 48 hours based on what I've got here. And that's being, and I set the Airstream up just for that potential to improvise. Mm-hmm. In my battery box, there's 75 amp power poles, which I can jumper to. So if I'm going to play field day when we're out camping, mm-hmm. I'll jack into that and set up my bench completely off of that rather than be, you know, in the trailer. And that just so happens to be coincident with I can jack in the rest of the battery pack in the house to do that. So, you know, I could be 1E pretty quick sitting in the same shack and running all this stuff that's behind me on what I've got stacked up. Luckily, I've got a lot of batteries. I just got gifted 36 very huge AGM batteries. I'm bringing up to speed, so it's a good chance to work those out.
Yeah, I saw a picture yesterday, the day before you posted of that pile of batteries that you're working through.
Come get to, you're supposed to come. Oh, that's right.
I was going to come. I had plans to come. In fact, I think that was a week after I got sent home from work for good. Was supposed to be the rally, which they canceled, sadly. And I was planning to take a couple of those home. Actually, I have a couple. I have been charging batteries to maintain mine to get ready too. I have a couple of, they're 185 amp hour. They're big. Wow. They're over 120 pounds a piece. And I dragged those out of the garage and have them sitting charging for the last couple of days. And I'd much rather have the smaller. I got a couple of 85s too. The 85s are a little more manageable.
Yeah, these weigh 97 pounds. They're not going in the backpack on a soda trip.
Yeah, so yeah, yeah. I've got
kilo some drop maybe, but
I got some 20 amp hour BioNOs for the backpack stuff if I need to do that. But yeah, these are not going anywhere. These I can barely pick up and put in my truck if I need to.
So another aspect we just talked about too is getting messages passed as an exercise, not just racking up something in the logbook, mm-hmm. but you know, listening to other people outside of your normal Aries protocol and mm-hmm. figuring out, you know, scribbling down a message and getting it across country. So if we're still good, if the Elmers are picking this up and our audience here is picking this up, we're looking for radiograms. We want to, mm-hmm. you know, whether you're doing it from your 440 Simplex handheld in Florida or your big 146 5.2 rig on the hilltop in North Dakota or something. You know, we want to know who's out there. So get us a radiogram. And
absolutely.
Do we count as press? Is that PR?
No. But so, and that was one of the things that we covered in the presentation I did for the Aries group. So there are a bunch of different bonus points category. And again, disclaimer, not a, not a contest. I'm going to keep saying that over and over again until you get sick of it. But one of the ways you can earn points in this not a contest is by sending message traffic. And there's one single 100-point category where if you send to your section manager a radiogram that leaves via RF, it's got to leave RF, so you got to make sure you do that. That's worth 100 points. And obviously sending it to us, because neither of us are section managers, won't qualify in that area. But there's a second one that goes along with that is if you send a radiogram to an individual and, again, leaves via RF, you can send, for one, it's 10 points. And for up to 10, you can earn another 100 points. Again, not a contest. By sending radiograms. So if anybody out there is listening, write down our call signs. And my call sign at ARRL.net works. Are you a member? Are you got yes. the mail forwarding going?
Yes.
So or Jim's call at ARRL.net will work for radiogram traffic. And if you want those bonus points, we're 20 free points right there. And you know what I talked to for our group, and I'll talk to our group right now that's listening to us. I highly encourage you use this opportunity of field day to reach out to your out-of-state emergency contacts and send them a radiogram. Because in a disaster, that might be the only thing. And I'll also warn you now, because you have 2 weeks, let them know ahead of time that it's coming, so that when somebody calls them from their community saying, hey, I got a message from David Goldenberg from you from across the country, they don't treat them like a wacko and hang up the phone. I do this every year. We reach out to, we actually have two out-of-state contacts, one in the middle of the country and one on the East Coast. And I let them know, hey, I'm going to send you this message and somebody's going to call you and give it to you. And just thank them, be nice to them. And if there's really a disaster, this is the way I'll get you a message if you care. And it works, and it works really well. And, I send the rest of those radiograms to, you know, other folks in our Aries group. I'll send one to my DEC and the other ADECs. I'll probably send Jim one. And it's just an opportunity, first of all, that if you haven't done a radiogram before, you can go online and pull down a form that you fill out, and there will be somebody in your community that will take that RF traffic, and you may need to look around or reach out to your local groups to find out who's going to take that traffic. But it is it's a good practice. This goes to this not a contest is an emergency preparedness exercise. Part of the reason why we log for all that information is we're practicing our copying skills and getting our speed up, and whether that's voice, you know, FM or single sideband or CW or some of the digital modes. It's all just practice on those skills that we need to have. And one of those skills might be sending a radiogram to someone who wants to their relative far, far and away to know that, hey, they're safe and alive and are okay. So send those radiograms.
Well, I think another thing that's important in the not a contest, especially at this point, is that this may be one of the few ways annually, aside from Santa nets, mm-hmm. that we get to let the public and probably by extension various agencies mm-hmm. know that we exist.
Yep.
And we can show that by participation once the scores are in, and even just, you know, just a feel for what the activity is. If you can do that with local press or whatever, but you know how it's going during the weekend is going to be a big thermometer of how viable amateur radio is, even in terms of a lockdown. We can't get out and do our big engineered contest winning stations, but are we still here and viable and alive? And that can be something that ARRL can take to the bank. See, look, we're all locked down, but we're still here. We're still doing stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. And I know, from past experiences, I will send out some press releases, that those aren't other points. Advertise that you're doing this. You can do it on social media. So I'll be, on our Facebook page, I'll be on my Twitter account, if I can remember what the password is. And, and I'll, you know, share that I'm doing this. And if you want to know more information, you know, reach out to me or come stand in my driveway and wave hi. I probably won't invite served agencies or public figures because probably not coming this year. But you never know. And I might actually have a served agency stop by just to explore what I'm doing in my front yard because we're going to be quite the spectacle. And I don't know if it counts if the local sheriff's department comes to investigate what's going on, if that counts as a visit. But if I can take a picture with them,
you've got to turn it into that moment.
I'm gonna take a picture with them, and we're gonna totally turn it into that moment.
I'd say get 11 people at the end of your driveway.
Yep.
And you've crossed the threshold.
Yeah, that's right.
Certainly gonna get the social justice police out.
Oh yeah, we're not doing that.
Check out what's going on.
We're not doing that. If they're at the end of the driveway, I think we might be okay. I mean, I got 7 people in the house here. All I need to do is have 4 more come, and when we've hit that. But
there you go. There you go. Yeah, I guess we could have a swimming party, and I have the kids send messages too. But I think it's still a chance to count, and probably. Again, more importantly, what your station can do versus, all those big contest stations that have got it all set out. I know, most of the groups around here always go to the same spot. Yep. They've got the same tree.
Yep.
40-meter tent is always in this place. And some of that is arranged because of RF issues.
Mm-hmm.
So they've had to engineer making sure that 20-meter CW and 20-meter sideband are, separated and those kinds of things. Let's do this without the big guys telling us how to set up the station and make it work.
Well, and I think again, that's part of the reason why I'm so encouraged why this could be, that field day moment where people really do this stuff. I've gone, I'm not super RF technical, but I'm hardware technical, right? Like long years of, PC, printer, hardware, networking background. I can put stuff together. I can take it apart. I can solder, fix it. I can do all that stuff. So I have become one of the tech folks for our field day site, right? I'm not an awesome operator, no CW. I can work. And if you put me in front of a radio that nobody else is grinding away on, I will work and I'll rack up points when I can. But my value has been for our organization is coming and figuring out, no, this wire needs to go there, or this thing needs to stand up this way, or if you try to stand it up that way, it's going to fall over. That's kind of the value I bring. And I like doing that. I don't mind playing that role, but it means a lot of other people don't have to like stand there and scratch their head saying, well, how do I get it up over that branch? Or how do we stand this up so it stays? Or how do we make that safe? And everybody's going to have that opportunity in their own little, section of wherever they're going to play to like, stop and think, well, how do I make that work? And
well, the downside is we could see more domestic EMS calls for amateur radio accidents.
that's very possible. I am lucky here. Careful. That there are no overhead power lines. So
I got high voltage in front of me and in back of me. My crossbow has got to be pointed very carefully.
Very carefully.
This place. But I think all the wire is up, and now that I think we're done with some of the patio, I can put the 31-foot random vertical up and play with that. I've got to fix a vertical in the backyard, just so I've got that to deal with. But I think it'd be kind of fun, if the bands aren't too busy and there aren't a bunch of pileups. If you've got two antennas set up for your station, is take the time and do an A-B comparison while you've got that contact there.
Yeah.
And figure out if the vertical or the dipole works, and then go back and figure out where people were, the time of day, and understand the propagation that works for that.
I think that is a great idea. So where are you going to work? You're going to work one echo?
I'm going to try to, yeah.
Yeah, your station as it sits today on emergency power.
Yeah, and I could actually, I've got another operator here. If she'll come out and operate, I can put her on 5-2.
Mm-hmm.
So we could be 2 echo if she's up for
it. If you're running. And, I talk to the kids and I'm there like, well, maybe a little bit, Gwen, my older daughter used to come every day to field day, and the whole weekend and wouldn't go home. And even when I told her like early Sunday morning at 4, we're going to go home because I want to have a shower and then we'll come back, within an hour or so and bring donuts back for the guys and whatever. I don't know if I want to leave. And when it came to me leaving, she'd come with me, but then she'd want to come right back too.
Cool.
But she's reached the age where she's like, I don't know, maybe not, we'll see. I think I might get my dad down a little bit. If I can pump the power up enough so that he can hear, he might operate a little bit. We'll see. I think that'll be fun. I want to segue to the ARL has made some changes. And that's why I asked you what you were going to work, Echo, One Echo, One Delta, whatever. And as we're showing here for 2020, the ARL, they're paying attention. They're reading the newspaper. They know what's going on in the world. They decided to make some temporary changes. And one of the changes was for field day stations for 2020 only, Class D stations may work all other stations. So in the past, if you were a Class D, and basically Class D is your station as it sits today on commercial power, as I understand it. That's about right. And in the past, you could work your station as it sits today on commercial power, but you can't log contacts with other Class D stations as they sit today on commercial power. And I understand why, because this is supposed to be an emergency preparedness exercise. You should see who you could talk to that isn't in that configuration. This year, they said, hey, you know, we want people to still come in out and play. And so they're allowing D stations to work other D stations. That makes sense to me. I get it. In addition to that, this one, I'm not sure how we're going to report it, but I'm on board with this one too. In addition, for 2020 only, aggregate club scores will be published, which will be the sum of all individual entrants indicating a specific club, which is similar to other aggregate scores for other ARRL affiliated club competitions. And I'll admit freely, I don't do a lot of contesting. This is my one big not a contest contest that I do every year. And so I guess somewhere on your log, you're going to write, I would have been working with this club, and they'll put that all together. And those
them up.
Yeah, exactly. So I'll put in, you know, I'm still on the fence. I might be one Bravo if I take everything outside, and depending on how the weather is and how I feel that weekend and my back and all the other stuff, I may just roll back and be one Echo as well. 'Cause I have the battery power and the solar to be able to run what I have here as it is. Part of me wants to like pick it all up and put it all in the driveway and work like I would have for field day. We'll see how it happens. And then I guess at the top of my report somewhere I put in there, the club would have been, Aries LAX, and that would be the club that I work at. And I guess everybody else that would report Aries LAX, as long as we figure out the right nomenclature, they would sum all of those things up. It makes sense to me.
Interesting.
And so that they'll report both what I would have done as an individual, and then they'll have an aggregate club score. I'm hoping that for our club, it will drive the aggregate club score up over previous years.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Yeah, it could be. It could be good. Not to say that we don't do a good job, but we don't. You know, usually last couple of years we've been a one. Before that, we used to be a two, and we've had dwindling participation. Some of it is age. We're all aging, and some of it is sometimes it's really hot here. We've had 110 degree field days. Nobody wants to be outside under an easy up pounding on a radio for that. So those are like the big changes for this contest. And I'm glad they did it. It makes sense to me. I know that they want to drive some participation. I can see why they'd want to do that. I want to do that. I want to have participation going on.
Well, it'll be interesting to see how the classification scores shift, mm-hmm. and overlay that however you want on local conditions, et cetera, to see what's going on. But it's a visibility thing. Get the points up and let's show that we're still here. And if you didn't count fixed stations in this, we might not ever know that number,
right?
Unless it's plucked out of other data,
right? And I think too, back to the I'm struggling how I'm going to operate, because I want this to be, quote unquote visible. I that's why I keep going back to the I'm going to be, one Bravo or maybe two Bravo if I can get the kids to come out and play. Because I want to set up, out in my driveway, out on the street, so that people can see what's going on. Otherwise, if I'm, even if I do station as it sits here, I'm still going to put up my temporary tower, because that's all I really have here anyways, in the front yard. Actually, I have two of them, and I'll probably put G5RV up in one and 40 and 80 meter dipole on the other, again, to do what you're saying, to compare, here's what I can hear with this and here's what I can hear with that, to just do some testing around that. But I want the public to see what I'm doing. And I would stop and talk to them, because that's what field day is all about. And I have that kind of personality, I guess. I know there's some of the guys in our group that would be, you know, get off my lawn, kids. And I don't have lawn, but I'd say, get off my decomposed granite, kids. But I do want, I want folks to know, like, you know, this is what amateur radio is about. And as I said, that one-page letter that the ARL put out about what is field day, we usually post that or something like that at the entrance to our field day site next to the public information table. And I will put that down at the end of my driveway with on an easel, that folks can see both directions, you know, coming from both sides. And I might tie a cheap Baofeng HT on there on like GMRS frequencies, so that if somebody wanted to like call and say hi, I can call back and say hi to them and go down and talk to them. Who knows? We'll see. But I want it to be a public facing kind of thing. Cause I think, like you said, that being able to show, you know, not only our served agencies, but our community around us, that we are here and we can help. Now, I also know the flip side of that is all my friends say, hey, when the apocalypse hits, we're all coming to your house. I don't want the whole neighborhood to come to my house when it.
Please don't. Yeah,
yeah, please don't. Because we won't.
You can hold up a paper airplane and send it across the driveway. Yeah. And I'll send
your radiogram away. But yeah, don't expect that I have lots of extra supplies or we'll take care of you, because I'm not going to do that.
Yeah, I think it'd be kind of fun. I could set up in the front yard and with a rig, or I could do the flex remotely on a laptop, and right. I'm still within 1,000 feet.
Yep.
I just got to put up with a lot of puppy QRM, because the more visitors out the front, you know, the more barking.
More barking you're going to hear. Yeah,
I don't think I can count those.
Right. You know, that was something interesting. You mentioned the 1,000 foot. And that's part of the rules. And again, if you're interested and you're still not sure about field day, if you go to the ARL website, you can download it's a 12-page rule book, about what you can do, what you can't do and whatever. And I would highly, highly, highly encourage that you do that. I had heard some of the other podcasts out there talking about, oh, well, with the changes in the rules and you could do this and you could do that. There are folks trying to figure out, well, you know, if we set up a remote station, like you've got the flex radios, and somebody was saying, oh, we'll just send Maestros to people. Well, I know that's not cheap. And then they can operate over the internet. And I wonder what you think. There was some speculation back and forth, and I believe that wouldn't follow said rules, as again, that 1,000 foot circle for operators is, I think that's it, golden, right? And if you're outside of that circle, you can't actually operate that radio, or at least for points. And I don't know.
Well, the whole point is whether it's MCOM or just see what your station can do.
Yep.
There's a great DX station, all full SDR, on the hilltop next to my repeater, and you know, that'd be wonderful. I could, you know, that'd be a killer.
Yeah.
But that doesn't exactly represent, well, we don't know yet that might not represent the only working available HF station that wasn't bombed out on the ground.
Right.
That somebody could get to. But then you've got a limited access situation going on there.
Yep.
That the whole idea is do something you wouldn't normally do.
Right.
In that stress condition. But I think, again, in a lot of cases, be it civil or natural disaster or whatever, that we're going to be in situations where the most we can leave home is, you know, to the back 40 that, you know, might be protected from fire or, you know, not flooded or something. Mm-hmm. So the idea is do something different with your equipment in the most extreme circumstances you can come up with.
Yep.
But I'm to that, I'm more than willing to allow that, you know, 1D exception or the D-class exception, because most of us are going to start out our operation from home.
Right.
That's going to tell us whether to deploy. In some cases, some remote areas, that might be the only indication, only comm you have to know to get out mm-hmm. and take action. You know, do you shelter in place, or is there an evacuee place that my family's supposed to go to? Mm-hmm. That sort of goes to the the brush fire, the CAL FIRE brush fire situation, is how much communication is there available, for community areas. And those of us at home may be the only communication. If we were to all go off during an earthquake and leave our neighborhood, and there weren't any other hams in the neighborhood, well, there's some validity of being that one ham that sticks around.
Mm-hmm. So. Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, I think that these are all worthy things to think about. I definitely want folks to think about what you're going to do, and there's still time. If you need to borrow equipment, call me up. I know some hams are watching from my community. You know, I got a little bit of spare stuff here and there. Call an Elmer, call someone you worked with before and say, hey, can I borrow this? Can I borrow that? Or offer to loan somebody something that you think that they might operate and do their thing. But we should get out there and participate. And again, as I said, I have been playing around with, that was weird. I have been playing around with what am I going to do for field day?
And oh yeah. Show your kit.
I'm going to show you. Yeah. So I had a little extra time, to think about what I'm going to do, and, shot a little video. And I'll tell you, it's painful for me to watch, me on video, but, this is my front yard from the part that you can see. And, I have, one of these, portable, fiberglass, actually it's fiberglass and aluminum, antenna mast kits. And, we use this for field day. We've used this for field day a number of times. And sometimes this was one or two of the years, this was the only tower we had. Other years we've had folks bring in either a trailer that had a tilt up or one that we could stake in the ground. But in my front yard, I could put this is 30 feet. I could put this up by myself, and you're going to see it done in about 2 minutes here. This is high speed, as you can tell. I can do this in about 12 minutes and get, a dipole or a vertical up in the air. And I'm going to put two of those up in the driveway, up in the front yard there. And I got enough space in the front that I can do an 80 meter, and I do the G5 RV and probably a 40 meter antenna as well. And probably set my easy up in kind of in between, and table and batteries. And I'm going to do it all disconnected from the house. Again, that's my goal would be 1B. So that if there was that, the terrible California disaster where we all shook and there's no infrastructure left, that I could be here, sending in radiograms from my neighbors and looking for traffic and whatever. And oh, here I'm doing safety first, staking this thing down. And I like this tower. It's pretty quick and easy to set up. I actually have had my scouts, we do a jamboree on the air every year. I have them set it up. I do a little supervising, make sure that nobody's toppling it over. But when you stake it at the bottom there, you can actually push that thing pretty hard from any of the sides, and it doesn't come down. And I put long wires on that, and it works good. And that's probably how I'll operate. I've been toying around with putting up. I used to have a big pole in the backyard. I've got like a 40-foot TV antenna, push-up kind of thing, for permanent mount. And I keep thinking about putting that thing back up with pulley and stuff, so I can put some wires up there permanently.
There you go.
Someday. I need more than my hands to be able to get that thing up in the air. But yeah, that's what I'm going to do. And I think everybody should think about, what do you got in your garage? What do you got in your neighborhood? Who can you reach out to? And again, if it's just sitting in your car with your mobile rig or at your, kitchen table with your mag mount on a cookie sheet, at least take that out on the patio so you get a little more distance. But, get on and work. If you're working UHF, VHF, think about that wilderness protocol. If you're working the HF, just play around. The first year that I went to field day, our section manager at the time, I had been logging, and he sat down and with me for a little bit, and you know, kind of asked me what I knew, and he kind of gave me the crash course on, you know, there's two ways to do it, as you talked about. You know, there's hunt and pounce or own a frequency, and I learned a lot from him about that, and I part of the reason I think I look forward to Field Day every year, because that thrill of the chase or the fear of the big pileup. it's exciting. It's, you know, at 2 a.m. when there's just, you know, camp lanterns around you and it's quiet and everybody else is snoring and you're working the folks that have got up a little early on the East Coast. It's fun. It's exciting. I really do enjoy it.
Well, and it's a good chance to get in that operating experience again. That's not, your pre-programmed Aries protocol stuff, which no matter how much you practice it, I think, you know, unless you're on the air and you're handling exchanges and getting on the air becomes a conversation, you know, it's a little awkward to sit there going, you know, that calling CQ. And then, you know, it's, if you've got mic fright, calling CQ is the worst thing you want to do.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, somebody might actually call me back.
Right.
Then what do I
do? And then what do you do?
Yeah. You know, so you work with somebody on that. And, if you're, you know, pouncing around you, it gives you an opportunity to figure out what, you know, there's no courtesy beep.
Right.
You know, when you think they've stopped talking,
yeah,
then, you know, then it's go. Operating sideband or simplex is a completely different thing. And yeah, I think sideband's tougher because there's no squelch tail.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you really don't get to see the meter go from full to zero and all these kinds of characteristics.
You can listen to the niceties and the cues that they're okay, we are done talking. Oh, wait, no, they're saying more. No, they're done talking. You jump in.
And it's all okay. It's all okay.
Absolutely. And they may not even hear you.
Yeah. The one field day when I first moved out here, a club invited me up, while a friend was going, and I said, well, let me go see what a field day is like, you know, is in California, like it was in Wisconsin and all that. And sure enough, it was. And I didn't sign up for a particular station because everybody had their place they wanted to be. Mm-hmm. Fred is always on 40. You know, nobody works with Fred except his logger. You know, that kind of stuff is kind of funny. So I had nothing better to do. Nobody else was around. I got on the GOTA station, and I think I wiped out their threshold for an afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
And then visitors started coming up and said, well, Jim kind of screwed the GOTA stations.
Yeah.
We got to wait a couple hours.
Yeah.
But I just, you know, A, you know, I started doing the CQ and being there, and then I got pounced on, and it was great. And then it, you know, you just switch over to, okay, I've exhausted that spot. You know, it's time to move on and find somebody else. And from working other people, responding to their CQ, the whole thing you learn too is that other people go, oh, there's a six. I haven't gotten that six yet. You know, and you're looking down the log going, I need that county. So the more you're there and present, the more that happens. It's geometric. It just keeps going. And it gets in your blood. I mean, you can be really scared of it at first. Kind of go, blah, what do I do? What do I do? And then you finally click that I can do this. And then more people want to talk to me. And it's sort of about you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm popular and I can't say no. I can't not answer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you've got to take a break, okay, you go QRT and you let everybody know and you come back in 5 minutes. But that's kind of an interesting way to just make this whole thing organic versus a mechanical. I went to the watering station. I gave out 5 water bottles. Last runner passed. We're done. You know, thank you for your service. But, you know,
that's definitely not
really knowing what we're doing here.
It's not definitely the regular public service event.
Yeah.
And it's interesting. The 2 years ago or 3 years ago when we didn't do like an official field day station because it all kind of fell apart and we didn't get the location. I did a drive around and I went and saw a bunch of other setups all around the city. It was a little disappointing that we didn't get to do our event because there were some issues with the college and new management and did they want us there or not or whatever. And it's fine. We worked it out. And our traditional field day was, you know, usually it was 2 alpha and the free VHF and then a GOTA station. And it wasn't really so much people had assigned stuff. There was always assigned for the GOTA because it was, you know, your radio and your GOTA, and you need to manage that with the people. And sometimes we had the right people working with the general public, and sometimes not so much. Something to consider, clubs. Think about that for next year. And you just kind of bounce around when people, you know, people would work for an hour and they'd get tired and then they'd circle out and then they'd put somebody else in. Some of the other clubs up in a little bit north of here, just into Ventura County, that club there, they do a huge, I don't think it's 12 or maybe more. And it was very much like you said, like Bob had the 40 meter station and Eddie had the digital station and Charlie had the this station, and they were all spread out. They had these huge military tents that they pulled up with them. And you know, kind of went side by side, and they had a whole farm they set up on a I think it's an elementary school property that one of them has a connection to. And so the whole grass field is full of antennas, and then there's next to it are their tents. And it was very, very much assigned, you know, this one's working this and this one's working that and this one. And it was great because everybody was welcome to come and see. They did a really good PR. Here, go see this person, and they're doing single sideband on this, and this one's doing RIDI, and this is what RIDI is, and this one's doing that. And then I went to other stations where, you know, it was just one table, and you know, we're doing only QRP, or we're doing only CW, or we're only doing this, and it was great to see. I don't think we'll ever, for our group, would ever get into the either that large of a population, so we get into 10 or 12, because there's just not that many folks that have the equipment and want to get out and spend that whole weekend. And then I think we're not also as specialized to say we're just going to work CW modes, because that puts people like me out. And gosh, the second or third year that I did field day and I was really hooked and spent the whole night, at one point somebody grabbed me and said, "You need a log. We need a logger." And everybody's having a break. I don't know if it was dinner or tired, there wasn't enough people there. And I sat down next to it was a Mark K6FG, and Mark's a CW guy, and I'm like, no comprende. and he was great. He's like, "That's okay, don't worry about it. You just write it down, and I'm gonna write it down, and you watch what I'm writing down, and I'll talk to myself as well, and you catch what you can." And after about 15 minutes, he didn't even stop to say, "Did you catch it?" And he'd look up on the screen every once in a while. He's like, "Oh, you got it." And I still maybe know 8 letters of Morse code, and that's it. But it was so much fun.
I got to tell you.
It was so much fun.
CW, you know, since I grew up with this stuff, and I've been going to field day since I was 5, everybody expected that I'd have my extra, you know, when I was 6 or something. Mm-hmm. And when I finally got into it, the most intimidating thing were, you know, a couple of the best Elmers in town. They were ex-military CW operators that paired up and owned a 20-meter CW. Mm-hmm. And they were ripping contacts out at 60 words a minute. You just go by their tent and you're, drr, 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 drr. Okay, that was another 7 contacts right there. And I'm going, that was total intimidation to me. Uh-huh. Never, ever take a new ham by the high-speed CW tent.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, walk him into this a little carefully. Slowly. Because it'll be 10 years before you pick up a key and get your 5 words a minute, if at all. And it was that kind of weird that, you know, I thought I should have just had a ham license because I've been a ham since I was, you know, born.
Right.
Little did I know I had to do that little bird chirping stuff. And that was, that was pretty bad, because, you know, now we've kind of flipped around to anybody can be a ham versus some, you know, putting an effort into it. But then that's why we Elmer folks, to make sure that they turn out to be good hams.
Absolutely.
So it's all good all the way around. Just you gotta find that opening and make it work.
Yep. All right. So I think we should wrap it up. First of all, number one rule for field day. Have fun.
Do field day.
Do field day. Yeah. Have fun. Safety. That would make safety third, right?
Yeah.
Do it. Have fun. Safety third. But just get out and operate, and don't be intimidated. Even if it's an HT, just do it. And, remember, for the newbies out there, your call, your class, your section, and the class part's pretty easy. If you're at home and you're on an HT, you're pretty much one echo and then it kind of goes up from there. You can go on the ARL field day site and search for the rules. The rules make it pretty easy and straightforward. You know, ones are 1As are clubs, 2s are individuals, up to 3 or something like that, and then so on and so forth. Cs are mobile, and I don't think we're going to see a whole lot of Fs this year. Those are operators working out of emergency operation centers. I'm not sure how many emergency operation centers are going to be opening to the general public, but I could be wrong.
They could be. I don't know how many 4s and 5s there are going to be. I mean, we were always like, you know, 5 alpha, you know, at the Four Lakes Club in Wisconsin. It was just a huge effort. And that's probably not going to happen.
I heard some chatter from some of the friends of ours. There's a group called the San Andreas Survivor Amateur Radio Club, and they go up to one of the mountains up here. I think it's Mount Abel. Top of the Cajon Pass, really great location, very quiet in the wilderness. They get a campsite, and I think the campsites are open now, so I think they can probably do that. And they're going to just do that. You know, they're going to figure out what's 1,000 feet, and they're going to, I think they work 3 or 4 stations, and they're just going to be, you know, socially distanced, and they do their own, you know, everybody does. Again, I got the 20 meter station, you got the 40 meter station, and that's where they're going to run. So there may be a couple of those here and there. But again, get out and operate, and I hope I work you.
Yeah, well, we'll have to figure out some way to do that.
Yep.
The only thing I may have to do to get into Field Day Spirit is fire up the generator or have a big long running sound loop, because Field Day just isn't Field Day without bratwurst on the grill and the drone of going to bed with a generator in the background.
Yeah, you know, I have a generator that I got at the end of last year. It's sitting on the patio, still in the box. This might be the reason I take it out and run it. I know I got to run it. I think I got to run it for 5 hours and then change the oil. This might be the reason I pull it out and run it. Otherwise, I was going to run all battery. But
well, that's one way to get the neighbors to come out going, what's David doing now?
Well, and that's the other thing too, is I'm also a little bit of like, I don't want to advertise I have a generator, but I don't, you know, I don't know. Actually, I could in the back patio next to the pool, there's a kind of a closed-in patio, and that's where we next to is where we run the ceramics kiln for my wife. I could set the generator there. It's a little shielded from the streets. Maybe the neighbors would hear, but nobody else. I don't know.
Just tell them it's a pressure washer.
Yeah, there you go. That I'm running all night because I've got a lot of stuff to clean.
Yeah.
So all right. Thanks all for joining us. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG. This is
Jim Aspinwall, NO1PC.
And this was Ham Radio Now, episode number 421, Field Day 2020. Thanks for joining us. You know how we close?
I think I got it.
All right. I got to find the little flyout thing. There it is. Again, episode number 421. Thank you for joining us. Over and
out.
I can never hear that thing, but I think it's working.
The swish. We did get a swish.
Yeah. No, there's like a whole electrical feedback thing I just talked over. Okay. And in true... Oh, shoot. No, I didn't. In true Gary style, I'm going to keep recording because this is always the best part of the show. Well, this always was the best part of the show. And did I say it was the most important? I did in the beginning, right? I did.
Everything's the most important
part. Yeah.
That you do a show, show up, you operate.
I got beat up in the Facebook yesterday for my little test, and rightfully so, because when I closed, I didn't over and out. They're like, where's the over and out?
Oh, no.
Like, okay, it was just a test. We'll have to remember that. Actually, I have my little post-it notes up here. Did you check this? Did you check that? I'm going to put up a, next to my check your sound recording, I'm going to put up a, did you over and out? Maybe I'm going to actually have that like printed on real like one of those little flag signs like you put on your desk. Mr. Goldenberg, it'll say over and out. Figure it out.
Yeah.
So what do you think? You're going to do one Bravo from your front yard or one Echo from the shack? It's kind of probably pain for you to drag all things in the front.
Well,
a little bit, maybe for a little bit.
Well, yeah, I could put up the easy up and a table out there, and I could run coax back to the shack and, you know, jack in the TS-570 and run live out there.
Yeah.
You know, break, get a hernia hauling a battery out there.
No, don't do that. Don't do
but,
that.
But, you know, I don't think anybody around here cares much. Though we do have a lot of people who come by and walk their dog and whatever else. It'd be kind of interesting to be set up out there. I just have to keep, you know, our herd of furry things in the backyard.
So they're quiet.
Yeah.
Yeah. My herd of furry things, they only meow and they'll all sit in the window watching me.
Oh, well, yeah. The cat has become one of the other big things.
Oh, the cat's a pain? The cat can't be a pain.
He's getting old and he's, I don't know. He wants everything. Yeah, but cats are that way.
Yeah.
But I'm pretty sure, well, I don't know. I think if I brought Cappy out and had him leashed in the front yard with me, he might just get tired of other dogs passing by and just kind of hang out. Mm-hmm. It's kind of funny. He and Nikki, well, I could bring Nikki out there. She doesn't react at all, at least around me. When they're around Kathy, there's a protective thing or they feed off each other and they just go absolutely nuts. But if I take Nikki out, she's just kind of like, oh, that's another dog. And Kathy's going, that's another dog.
Yeah, he's the one that's like, get off my lawn, right?
Yeah, yeah, he's Walter.
You're too close. Get off my lawn.
You're in my neighborhood.
Yeah. See, and we're on kind of a divided, not highway, well, it's, I mean, it's Mulholland Drive, but it's, you know, two lanes in each direction with the divider in the middle. And there's a lot of walkers that walk or jog or bicycle out front. In fact, the last couple, I think the video I showed was me setting up the 80 meter dipole, the our Aries group on Sunday mornings at 8:45. We do 80 meter net. And well, you joined us for one of those, or you tried to join us for one of those. When I set up that, I had one of the bikers go by, a lady who was on the biker who drove by, and she squealed on her brakes. And you know, this was like, you know, the 18 speed, whatever. And there's a whole group of them, and she's like, "What are you doing?" She was all interested. And then we had a nice conversation. I'm like, "Well, you know, I'm doing this emergency preparedness thing, and I'm setting up this radios and this and that and whatever." And she's like, "Oh, that's cool." And then she rode off. It's like, great. Those are the kinds of interactions I'd love to have on field day.
Yeah, well, I think that might help explain a lot to the neighbors. Even none of the neighbors have ever, in the 20 years we've been here and through the little snits with some of them, said, and then we have these people with these radio antennas in their yard.
Uh-huh.
There's only one.
Yeah.
I know who you're talking about.
They know who it is when they talk about it, huh?
Yeah, nobody's ever said a darn thing about it. Of course, I think only two neighbors would have ever been affected by TVI if that were to ever happen. But you know, we're all on cable, so you know, nothing. It's all pretty cool. I've got two other hams in the neighborhood that I know of. One of them, well, maybe I can encourage Steve to get on. He just came and picked up a set of batteries. I know he's got an HF rig or two. He says, "I got to have you over to hang up a wire." And I said, "Just make sure the beer's cold. Let's go."
There you go. Yeah, I'll admit I did one auto installation during Corona lockdown on a Sunday right after the HF net. Walter showed up with his it was like a 4Runner. And, you know, masks and gloves and whatever. And it was kind of fun. We did our thing.
Yeah, luckily Santa Clara County has been pretty minimal for exposure. They know where most of the cases have come from. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there may be a rebound. I don't know. I, you know, had occasion to visit a Kaiser ER in the middle of all this and, you know, go through the...
You're still good.
The filtering process. And it was a little... It was a little strange, but I don't know. The Kaiser's now, they're starting to figure out that, well, we're not killing people by having them come in for blood pressure checks. So they're, you know, having me come in. I've got to get this nasty thing removed next week. So you show up at the door, sanitizer, temperature check, you know, do you need a mask? And okay, you know, you're on your own. And there's 6 feet little markers all the way up and down the hallway. And
yeah.
Part of the thing that is so annoying about it, at the very least, is the constant reminders that something's going on. Every other day from next door, somebody in the county, some next door group leader is, you know, there's a Karen going off about there were rude teenagers on my walk this morning. But that's any different than you normal. Know,
yeah.
Plus or minus the mask, but the constant barrage of this message is just like, okay, I get it. I'm getting all the social messages, the virtual signaling from work. And, you know, now we've got this whole new diversity thing we have to worry about. And, you know, all lives matter. There's just so much pile on of psychology going on here. Like, you know, I just want to get up in the morning, go to work and
do your thing.
Have a glass of wine. I'm not out to get you because I forgot my mask.
Well, that's in you. So you've been going to work, but I haven't been. Most of the people that I work with haven't been. There's 800 people in our building, and it's about 40 people a day that show up. And I know 12 of them have to be there because they can't do their jobs, because that's my job, is to know who can do what and where, and yeah. Continuity planning. And I wonder what the other people are doing there, but whatever. I have seen a shift here in Los Angeles. You know, I've been for the first, I don't know, 2 months of this all, I was the sole person to leave the house. You know, there's my 80-year-old parents live with us. And a couple of times when my wife did go out, she came back all freaked out because, you know, people are, you know, just weird, you know, the whole mask thing. And in the beginning weeks of all this, people were pushing and shoving and just, you know, like rude and whatever. But I was going out and getting the food and the, you know, whatever else that needed to be done, and the hardware store trips and what have you. And now it seems like for the last week or two, it's like almost back to normal when you go out there, except everybody's wearing a mask and there's lots of tape on the floor. There's just so many people out there. I don't know how it is up where you are, but it's almost like, not like it didn't ever happen, but... yeah, weird, very different.
Well, yeah, I'm the one that leaves the house to go get stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm probably the most at-risk person in the house.
Yeah.
No, you go out. You know, you were stupid and ran into burning buildings. I don't know what the whole thing is there. We have gone to the Home Depot together a couple of times. Mm-hmm. Going to work is... yeah, for some reason, you have to wear your mask the minute you go through the turnstile outside. Mm-hmm. I don't get that, but certainly when you get in the building and you're going to be passing other people, certainly mm-hmm. our help desk people, you know, I've got to deal with that. But once I get into my little locked sysadmin area at work, you know,
yeah, it comes
mask
off.
Is off. It's like, because you just, you have to get, you know, you want to get work done. You want to be able to have a cup of coffee.
Yeah. The rules is... the rules as I read it where I am, where I work, is, you know, if you're within 10 feet, 6 feet, 10 feet, something like that of other people. And, you know, I'm not lucky enough to have an office. There's actually very few offices. I have a 5 foot desk, and next to me is a 5 foot desk. And on the other side of me is a 5 foot desk, and behind me is a 5 foot desk. And if we're all in the office, we're wearing masks all the time. And I think the rules there are, if you're in a closed space, like, you know, our director has an office, and all the around the perimeter there's offices, those folks can take them off. Mm-hmm. I think I'll be wearing a mask all day, which is part of the reason why I keep telling them, I'm like, I'm doing my job and I'm going to plan to continue to do my job, and I can do that from here. I'll go in maybe every once in a while.
Well, yeah, if there's an open cubicle area where there's no physical barrier,
yeah,
then you got a mask.
You got a mask up.
Hopefully,
yeah.
We still got, you know, 5 foot walls. And
no, yeah, we changed all that. We actually came out of a building where everybody had a, you know, the old Herman Miller 10x10 cubicles with the 6 foot mm-hmm. walls, you know, and in that old space, probably we just, you know, you go sit at your desk and no mask and it won't matter, but we're all open, you know, the open IKEA tables that go up and down and whatever. And it's nice. And I almost miss that, the stand desk a little bit, but I don't miss that I have, you know, my, you know, workstation console inside the house is better than what I have at my desk at work, because I'm a tech guy and that's my thing, you know.
Yeah. Well, I, you know, even but my cubicle is pretty yeah. much looks like my office.
Right. Yep. Yep.
Here, because I've got, you know, my primary workstation to focus on email and reports and stuff. Then I've got two lab benches behind me that's piles of laptops and whatever else. So I got to jack in and spend time with. And some of the stuff I've learned that I don't have to wait an hour and a half for a system to reimage. I can fire up a VM and it'll be done in 30 minutes. Mm-hmm. So for stuff that doesn't involve actually testing on a piece of hardware, I've been beating the hell out of our VM lab from home. And you know, when you're writing a script and that script's got to fire off at the end of the process, you got to run through the process every time. Yep. So it's painful. And boss is going, how come it's taking you so long? I said, well, hey, I have to answer your email to tell you why it's taking so long. And then everything else.
Yeah, I miss those tech lab days. I spent a lot of years doing that.
But you know, we've got a new a young person in the help desk that's migrating over to sysadmin, and he was kind of quiet and didn't really we didn't get to know what he knew and how fast he learned things until he rolled over into sysadmin, and now he's beating on PowerShell and he's doing a whole bunch of stuff. And I said, you're going to come to work with me once in a while. I need some help. You're going to be doing updates on Sunday. We're going to ride herd until we can get him completely broken away from the help desk. And that's tough. You know, hiring people at this point is like, you know, we have to go to an off-net system to Zoom with them or something, or just do it all phone because we can't bring him in, or they don't want to come in for an interview. And that's pretty strange. So hopefully we'll get some of that. But I'm also used to working in environments where there were smarter people around me. I could call Microsoft and get a tech rep if I needed one. Mm-hmm. Yes, there are smarter people at corporate. They're too damn busy to bother with me, and I can't figure out which one does what I do at any point in time during the day. So I don't have any mentors. I feel really bad. We've got one very good sysadmin that when we can finally sit down and go through GPOs or Active Directory stuff, it's our time to have our individual bullshit session to go through stuff. And it's, you know, it's pretty bonding. But that doesn't happen often. And I can't ask him about the systems I work on because he doesn't understand SCCM and, you know, some of this stuff. So it's kind of stressful in some points. It's going to happen often. And I can't ask him about the systems I work on because he doesn't understand it.
Oh, sorry. I clicked over to the feed to make a comment.
To comment.
And I was surprised it's not that far behind us. I thought it was going to be a little further behind us, but it's not.
Well, that's pretty good.
Okay, cool. So I'm going to wrap up with you because I have to teach a class in an hour and I should have lunch. Thank you.
Yeah, I got to have lunch. Updates start at 2 o'clock. And I got to get enough headway there that I can break free.